Hey, what's up guys? Welcome back to Aimstone channel. As always, let's go ahead and start this video with Bitcoin market. Why? Because BTC is literally pumping. Bitcoin literally went from low $27,000 to slightly under $30,000. This is where it is trading at this current price and as of the time of this recording. Most likely, by the time you're watching this video, the price may slightly vary because it takes me a couple of hours to edit this video. In addition to that, Bitcoin literally broke through this 100 days and 200 days moving average. So there is a good chance the BTC may continue to go higher from this point on. Speaking of the market sentiment, currently Bitcoin Fear and Greed Index, it is at 56. We are at greed. We are slightly higher where we were back yesterday and last week. However, we are lower where we were back last month. And of course, tomorrow most likely we will be in greed when this Fear and Greed Index will readjust. Because look, we are slightly under $30,000. And who knows if BTC will continue to push higher prices. In my opinion, it will. But look, after 10% increase in the last 24 hours, maybe there could be some slight pullback. Around 4 days ago, I did this Bitcoin technical analysis and I uploaded in this video. Those of you guys who watch my videos are highly appreciated. And look, I'm not the type of guy who would say, hey, I told you so. But look, here we are, and Bitcoin literally going higher. And look, this technical analysis seems to be on point. Yes, it looks like we had some decent support at around $21,000 back in February and March. BTC broke slightly below it, then it literally skyrocketed. And then something similar played out at $28,000. Bitcoin has been wiggling around $28,000 in late March and early April. BTC price broke below $28,000 and now it's coming back hard. And there is a decent chance it might come back even harder where it was back last time. So look, I am very hyped up and I'm very optimistic about Bitcoin future, especially long-term future. And that's exactly what I am about to talk about. As you know, we are approximately 1 year before the next Bitcoin halving. In fact, we are 1 year and 1 day before the next Bitcoin halving that will take place in April 2024. And the Bitcoin block reward will drop from the current 6.25 to 3.125. Imagine every single block will give you only 3.125 BTC, which is of course not a lot, especially if you want to compare what happened after first Bitcoin halving, where BTC was literally spitting out 50 BTC per block. So yes, that's exactly what we want. And the Bitcoin price reflects that. After every Bitcoin halving, BTC literally skyrockets. But in this video, what I would like to talk about is what happens 1 year before the next Bitcoin halving, because we're currently exactly 1 year and 1 day before the next Bitcoin halving. So let's start with 2012. In November 2012, this is where the first Bitcoin halving took place. And look, what happened 1 year before that date? Well, in November 2011, BTC was literally under $2. And during the first Bitcoin halving in November 2012, BTC was literally at $12. So technically, within 1 year, BTC generated 6x. But what about the second Bitcoin halving? Well, let's take a look. The second Bitcoin halving took place in July 2016. And 1 year before the second Bitcoin halving, that was July 2015, BTC was literally trading at around $240 per coin. And during the Bitcoin halving in 2016, it was at $660 a coin. So technically, within 1 year period, BTC generated 2.8x. Now, let's take a look what happened during the third Bitcoin halving that took place in May 2020. Well, in May 2019, exactly 1 year before the third Bitcoin halving, BTC was at around $6,000. And 1 year later, in May 2020, during the third Bitcoin halving, BTC was at around $9,000. So technically, BTC generated 1.5x within 1 year period. However, on my opinion, if we would not have the Corona crash, that anomaly event, most likely BTC would be higher. But nonetheless, we're not going to manipulate the data and let's leave it as is. So technically, where we should expect BTC price to be at exactly the next Bitcoin halving that will take place in April 2024. Well, I think there is a reasonable expectation to assume that BTC could be somewhere around 1.5x and 6x. If BTC will be only 1.5x, it will be $45,000. 6x would put BTC over $180,000. Yes, that's a huge range, but personally, if we narrow the confident interval, I would think BTC can end up somewhere between 2x and 3x before the next Bitcoin halving. 2 to 3x would put Bitcoin in between $60,000 to $90,000 before the next Bitcoin halving that will take place in April 2024. And look, I am talking about only what we should anticipate 1 year before the next Bitcoin halving, but the real fun begins after the Bitcoin halving. Usually between 12 to 16 months after the next Bitcoin halving, this is where the real bull market starts. So yes guys, if you do not have enough sats right now, better start stacking right now before it is too late. As we know, this week is a huge week where public companies are releasing their earnings, and one of them is of course a bank that literally got tumbled in the last couple of weeks. First Republic Bank says deposit tumbled 40% to $104 billion in the first quarter. Look, only not so long ago First Republic Bank was over $120 a share. That was actually 2 months ago. And when banks started to fail, in fact, 5 banks failed in the United States, but of course, all of them got bailed out. The First Republic Bank literally dropped from $120 a share to around $16 a share. And then yesterday, when this statement was released, the shares dropped even further by almost 50%, going from $16 a share to this current price, slightly over $8 a share. And guess who's praising First Republic Bank? That is correct, Jim Cramer. In March, he stated that First Republic Bank is a new focus. Very good bank. Yes, this did not age too well. So it literally bank crashed by 95% since he posted this tweet. Here are some of the most important tech companies that released the earnings today. First we have is Microsoft. Microsoft literally beat everything. Revenue came up at $52.9 billion versus $51.1 billion expected. Adjusted EPS came up at $2.45 versus $2.23 expected. And they also beat other metrics such as productivity in business processes, intelligent cloud, and more personal computing. The next one on the list is we have, of course, Google Alphabet. Google Alphabet beat revenue and EPS as well. Revenue came up at $69.7 billion versus $68.96 billion expected. EPS also came up higher than expected at $1.17 versus $1.08. Google ad revenue also was beaten and YouTube ad revenue as well, $6.69 billion versus $6.64 billion expected. And yes, I literally make below minimum wage working on these YouTube videos for you guys. I guess that's exactly what happens during the bear market. And here's actually what we should anticipate today as well as tomorrow. Today, after hours, Meta, Facebook will release the earnings. And by the time you're watching this video, of course, you know what Meta earnings are. But personally, right now, I do not know because I'm recording this video prior to earnings release. On Thursday, we have Amazon, Intel, and MasterCard. And also today, it seems like the stock market is finally back in green after the past few consecutive days that is spent in red. So yes, now let's move on back to Bitcoin and take a look at some cool Bitcoin charts. This first chart represents Bitcoin supply in profit slash loss ratio. At the same time, this is great indication regarding market sentiment. As we can see, whenever this metric breaks below one level, this is great indication that the bottom was in any Bitcoin price. On the flip side, whenever this metric goes above 200, this is could be good indication that BTC could be overhyped up, overbought, and there could be more downside down the line. So look, back in November 2022, this metric spanned 36 days below 1, and that's exactly where BTC was wiggling around $17,000. In fact, it's very similar what happened during late 2011 in that bear market where BTC literally crashed from like $30 to $1 a coin. During that time, this metric also spent 37 days below 1 level. And then we also had some similarities during 2015 and 2018 bear markets. I do not know how about you guys, but this metric is indeed very bullish on my opinion. Here is the follow-up chart. This chart represents Bitcoin supply held by short-term hodlers. And look at this, every time the short-term hodlers sell their BTC, Bitcoin goes into the bear market. And when the selling pressure is overexhausted, this can actually be a good indication that the bottom was already in. That's exactly what happened in 2015 and in 2018. And look, this pattern is playing out once again. So yes, when the short-term hodlers sell their BTC, they sell into the long-term hodlers. And usually, when Bitcoin price goes up, they do not want to miss out. So the FOMO kicks in and they start buying BTC at any price. So they just follow the momentum. Therefore, when Bitcoin supply held by the short-term hodlers will skyrocket, it can actually be great indication that BTC can go higher, but eventually it will invert. So just keep an eye on this metric, because in my opinion it is quite important. Okay, now let's take a look at this quick video where Raoul Paul explains his main idea about macroeconomics as well what he thinks about Bitcoin and crypto overall. Let's take a look.
Okay, so what's on my mind right now? The first thing on my mind is liquidity. You saw my interview with Mike Howell. It was a very important interview. It's building on what I wrote in GMI called the Everything Code, and it's about liquidity, why liquidity matters, where it's going, where we are right now, and where it's going. And I think I'm able to forecast liquidity out for about 18 months, which may mean, and we'll have to wait and see, that that means I can forecast asset prices going out 18 months. It's a kind of ludicrous idea to think that I could do that. But that's what the Everything Code seems to suggest. And there's a huge, huge article I wrote in GMI about this. But just to give you guys an essence of what I'm talking about. So Brian, if you can pull up the first chart. And this is the chart of the Fed balance sheet against the NASDAQ. You're all aware of this. This is my thesis that debasement of currency is the driving the denominator lower. So every time the Fed prints, the stock market goes up in kind of nominal terms. But when you actually debase it by the balance sheet, it doesn't go up as much. So if I debase the S&P 500 by the Fed balance sheet, I divide one by the other, the S&P 500 has gone nowhere since 2012. Virtually nowhere since about 2008 when they started the debasement of currency by quantitative easing. Gold has actually given a negative return over that period of time. Real estate is marginally negative, but most people use leverage on real estate, so it's not a fair comparison. But the NASDAQ has done particularly well in crypto that I've mentioned before. So that chart shows you the relationship. Now, it's not perfect, but I think the Fed balance sheet grows. I put some of my target on here that it goes out to potentially $12 trillion, which might give a NASDAQ target of about 25,000, which is ludicrous over the next 18 months or so. Don't fixate on the target, fixate on the chart. But the second chart is the more important chart. So if you can bring the next one up, Brian, this is actually global liquidity. And now look at that fit. That fit is staggering. That fit is so good, you can't argue that there is not a very, very close ongoing relationship. And anybody who says, well, correlation is not causation, listen, you're missing the whole point. Tied in with global liquidity is equity markets. Now, when you say, oh, well, they print money and therefore money flows into stocks, is simply not provable by the volumes in stock markets. What actually happens is the Venezuelan situation where you debase the currency and the stock market automatically adjusts in price. My view is the central bank balance sheet goes out to about $12 trillion in the US. That takes all assets with it over time. NASDAQ, crypto do better. The NASDAQ does well. Crypto does ludicrously well. And that's how it always is with liquidity and these network adoption models. The S&P does fine. It does pretty much, I think the S&P does 2x. What the balance sheet does in percent. So the balance sheet fell about 15% and the stock market fell 30%. You know, it's that kind of relationship with the S&P. The NASDAQ's got a multiplier effect and crypto's got a multiplier effect on it, which is why I'm so bullish on those two right now based on my liquidity framework. Okay, what else on my mind? Crypto, obviously. Crypto's always on my mind. It's been doing phenomenally well based on liquidity. Bottomed exactly as we saw global M2 turning. That was my signal into that hellhole of June when Luna collapsed, and then the second hellhole of the FTX collapse, which ETH didn't take out the low. It bottomed in June, but Bitcoin and others bottomed in the October period, which I tweeted out about and talked about on Real Vision, which I thought was the low of the market. October is the bear market killer, and it seemed to have done its job this time around too. So I'm very positive overall.
Raoul Paul believes Federal Reserve Jerome Powell will expand United States balance sheet, as well as M2 global money supply will continue to expand as well. And therefore, Nasdaq stock market overall will continue to go higher. And we know what happens when the stock market goes higher. Bitcoin and crypto follow. If the stock market goes higher, Bitcoin crypto go parabolic. I don't know about crypto, but definitely Bitcoin. But we also know that Raoul Paul actually not so long ago sold majority of his BTC for Ethereum. Does that mean he is an official shitcoiner? I don't know, you tell me. Comment below, subscribe, and like this video.